My coverage of CES 2024 is brought to you by Cooler Master, Kioxia, Asus, and Gigabyte. Welcome everyone to my coverage of CES 2024. We are kicking things off with AMD's big announcements this morning. We actually have back-to-back videos this morning. There will be a follow-up one to this very soon. Can you guess what that is? Who knows? But if you missed AMD's actual presentation, or if you just want a quick recap and some of my feedback on it, you've come to the right place. We have a new Radeon GPU coming out, the Radeon RX 7600 XT with 16 gigs of VRAM, and we have not four, but eight new CPUs coming from AMD's client computing group. Some of those are for AM4 and some of those are for AM5. But let's start out with those graphics card announcements. The new RX 7600 XT, 16 gig. That's right, it's gonna have 16 gigs of VRAM, double the amount that the current RX 7600 non-XT has. AMD is very excited to point out that both cards are good in their own right, but both cards are actually very similar as well. But starting from the top, the RX 7600 XT is going to be launching on January 24th. It has a suggested retail price, or MSRP, of $329, $330, and that's about $60 more than the 7600 non-XT currently goes for, which sells for about $270. This slide compares the two cards, and my quick take was these are very, very similar cards in terms of the actual GPU itself. They have the same amount of compute units, the same amount of AI accelerators, the same amount of stream processors. We do have a slightly boosted clock speed with the game clock going up to 2.47 gigahertz now, and the boost clock going up to 2.76 gigahertz. But we also have the same memory bandwidth and the same memory speed, 128-bit bus, 18 gigabits per second, GDDR6 memory. We just have twice as much, going up to 16 gigabytes from 8 gigabytes. The only other real difference is an increased TBP, or total board power, going up to 190 watts from 165, and then of course there's that price difference of about $60 according to the MSRPs. There are two main reasons that AMD has increased the VRAM buffer on this card. One is so it's more ready for higher resolution gameplay, like going from a 1080p monitor that you might be running now to the 1440p monitor that you plan to upgrade in the future. Please also note that I'm sharing some of AMD's benchmark results here. These should be taken with a grain of salt, and you will want to wait until January 24th or thereabouts when review embargoes lift so that you can get some actual third-party testing and also compare this card to not just the 7600, but also to some other cards in its price range. AMD would like to compare this to NVIDIA's RTX 2060 6GB, which is getting a little dated at this point. They have a reason why they did that. It's because there are still lots of people using a 2060 6GB or less if you reference stuff like the Steam Hardware Survey. But AMD said that they designed this card for memory-dependent games as well as AI content creation workflows. And that's gonna be a theme, I think, not just for this video, but also a running theme for all of CES is AI everywhere and giving people more tools to do AI stuff. And whether or not you're into AI, you're gonna hear about it at CES one way or the other. Here's another handful of benchmarks, this time comparing to the RTX 4080 8GB, which is a more relevant comparison to what's currently available on the market. This chart's a little confusing though, because they're including post-processing techniques that have become pretty common and widely available, like FSR 2 and 3, using AMD fluid motion frames or frame generation. And then on the NVIDIA side, you've got DLSS as well as frame generation. So if you're looking at crazy high numbers like 254 FPS in Call of Duty Modern Warfare 2, you've got to consider that a good chunk of that is fluid motion frames, frames that are being generated outside of the typical GPU rendering pipeline, and the quality of those frames is sometimes not the best. Also consider that when you're adding generated frames with AMD or NVIDIA, there is a hit to response time too, so it's not necessarily 100% a benefit. I would also very much question the quality of the generated frames going between NVIDIA and AMD, and I'm not saying that one or the other is better currently. I'm just saying if you're looking at the frame rate results that they're showing here, those frames might not all be equivalent in terms of the quality of images that you're seeing on screen. Also note that as we switch from like 1080 results to 1440 results, you're not seeing all the same titles. And AMD also said, not all titles will see the same level of improvement. So this is just another example of why we ask you to wait for third-party testing before you make a final determination as to whether or not the RX 7600 XT 16GB is a good card or a bad card, because there's a lot more to be said than what AMD is revealing right now. One thing that is nice, at least in terms of general use of these new technologies, is the HyperRX function. And AMD does want to point out that both the 7600 and the 7600 XT are compatible with that. It's a one-click, easy solution to turn on FidelityFX Super Resolution 3, as well as Fluid Motion Frames in the games that support it. Even though I just said you shouldn't cast any early judgments, I'm going to kind of do that and at least give you my first take on this based on the specs and everything that AMD has come out with. It does seem very clear that they're courting the AI market with this, with their decision to go with the 16 gig VRAM frame buffer. A lot of cards that have 4 gig or 8 gig VRAM buffers struggle with a lot of generative AI models, and you have to do workarounds or just not do it if you're trying out AI on your graphics card. AMD is also pitching production tasks like Adobe Premiere Pro with the launch of this card, and given that it is a lower end card with the suggested price of about $330, making a card with that amount of VRAM available at that price could be a nice entry point for people who are looking for a combination gaming and production system, as well as some AI capabilities without having to break the bank and spend $500, $600 or more. I do hope that this card will further embarrass NVIDIA's RTX 4060 8GB and the RTX 4060 Ti, because those cards deserve further embarrassment. It's still too early to say how the performance is going to suss out between these cards once third-party reviews come into play, but I am also very curious how well it will stack up against the RX 7700 XT, which has a 12GB VRAM buffer and is currently available for about $430 to $440. But that is a quick rundown of the RX 7600 XT launching January 24th for $330 suggested ETEL price, and we do have pictures available from Acer, ASRock, ASUS, Gigabyte, PowerColor, Sapphire, and XFX. Next, let's talk about the other thing AMD does, and that's making CPUs. They had a few CPUs that they announced. They have the AMD Ryzen 8040 series processors. Those are mobile. We're not going to focus too much on them, but they are now adding an NPU. So we have a CPU, we have GPUs, now we have NPUs. That's what they're calling their AI acceleration hardware that they are now shoehorning into some of their CPUs. I say shoehorn, maybe I should say glue. I think the glue joke is played out. Anyway, they have a bunch of stuff on the 8840. Let's skip all that. And let's talk about the thing I want to talk about, the Ryzen 8000G series processor. These are desktop AM5 processors. And I know what you're thinking. Oh my gosh, Paul, is the next generation of AMD CPUs launching right here and now, the 8000 series? No. No, it's just what AMD is calling these CPUs. These are still very much Ryzen 7000 series desktop processors. AMD just changed the name to 8000 series to confuse people, to obfuscate what the CPUs actually are. I don't know why they make these decisions, but honestly, when it comes to dealing with like tech and hardware and the companies and their decisions for how to name things, this is one of the things that irritates me almost the most. But let me give you some hard data before I get too ranty here. We have four CPUs announced in this lineup. The Ryzen 7 8700G would be the top end one, which is 8 cores and 16 threads. 5.1 gigahertz max boost, a 24 meg cache setup, which is less than the 8 core 16 thread Ryzen 7000 series CPUs. But notably, we have the addition of AMD Radeon 780M graphics, and of course, Ryzen AI, that NPU, which is integrated into the top 8700G, as well as the 8600G, which is a 6-core 12-thread model with a 5 GHz max boost, 22 meg cache, and also AMD Radeon 760M graphics. And then we've got two more, the 8500G 6-core 12-thread and 8300G 4-core 8-thread. That's only going to be for partners, so the ones that are going to be available for desktop building and available standalone are the 8700G, 8600G, and 8500G, and the 8500G does not have that AI coprocessor. Now, the interesting thing about these, and the thing I would like to be talking about rather than complaining about them calling them the 8000 series, is the fact that they are APUs and they do have much better integrated graphics than we've seen from AMD in quite some time. The existing Ryzen 7000 series CPUs like the 7950X and the 7800X3D have integrated graphics, but it's really just a basic thing for some display output. It's not anything to game on. These actually do have much better integrated graphics, which is something I am genuinely somewhat excited for, but once again, we're seeing AMD benchmark results here that show you sort of the baseline and then like, oh wow, you're like triple the amount of frames because they're using fluid motion frames and doing frame generation, which might be totally viable. But I'd very much question, like, when you're getting close to double the frames in Starfield, and now that I look at this chart, I feel like this isn't even starting at zero or anything like that. It's not. 32 to 61, that's double. This should be at the halfway point. What a stupid slide. I'm not going to show you this slide anymore. And in fact, I now distrust all of these slides that you have made for your announcement, AMD. Why couldn't you have just skipped dumb slides that don't start at zero and naming your APUs wrong? And I could have just been like, hey guys, new APUs from AMD that are on the AM5 platform and could be great starting out points for people who want to build a system but can't necessarily afford a graphics card right out of the gate. And the integrated graphics in these probably kick the crap out of what Intel currently has, because Intel hasn't really been very competitive on the integrated graphics side in quite some time. The 8700G is going to be $330. The 8600G is going to be $280, or $279, and the 8500G is going to be $179. So note that CPUs like the 8600G, because this CPU has less cache, and because this CPU has a lower frequency, 5 gigahertz versus I think 5.1 for the 7600, it is not going to be as good of a CPU, and it's going to cost more. Now, granted, if you're going to be doing AI, and if the AI coprocessor turns out to be brilliant and amazing, that's one thing. And if you don't have a graphics card and you want something that you can game on, those might be enough value for you to pay a little bit more for these CPUs. But if you look at this chart, and this is pretty much all of AMD's kind of current generation CPUs on both the AM4 platform and the AM5 platform, you can see these 8000 series CPUs are slotting in lower than their 7000 series counterparts. And that's not how numbers are supposed to work. The higher number is supposed to be better, typically speaking. Oh, and you might also notice that there are new AM4 CPUs as well. So if I've ranted enough about the new 8000G APUs, maybe we can recover a little bit with these new Ryzen AM4 CPUs. Now AM4 is a last gen platform. It is technically end of life. This is the second or third time we've said no more CPUs for the AM4 platform, but AMD keeps making them. And for people who are building on a budget, it is still very viable. The 5700X 3D might be a choice CPU for some people, whether you're upgrading an existing AM4 platform or just trying to build something on a budget that can keep up really well. It has a $250 suggested detail price, 4.1 gigahertz max boost clock. And since it's an X3D CPU, it's got that 3D V cache, so 100 megabytes of cache. And this one should be very good at gaming, probably just slightly slower than the 5800X3D. And again, because you know people need more choice, I suppose, we have the Ryzen 7 5700. So now you've got the 5700X and the 5700. This one's also 8 cores and 16 threads with a higher max boost clock. So if you're going for pure CPU performance, this will probably be a better choice than the 5700X3D. And it's also $75 cheaper at $175. And then we've got a 5600 GT and 5500 GT. These have integrated Radeon graphics, so these again are kind of along the APU path. I noted here that AMD did not call these APUs 6000 series like the 6600 GT and 6500 GT. Why didn't you do that, AMD? Where's the consistency with trying to trick people into thinking that your CPUs are better than they are by giving them a higher number? Anyway, I will once again briefly show some of AMD's test results for the 5700XE. They're comparing it to the 13600K. Here's also some Ryzen 7 5700 gaming performance compared to the 12400F. Again, AMD's numbers. And here's the 5600 GT compared to the previously available 5600G, as well as the 5500G compared to the 5600G. But guys, that pretty much wraps it up for my recap of AMD's announcements here at CES 2024. Thank you guys so much for watching this video, and a big thank you to my sponsors for this event, Cooler Master, Kioxia, Gigabyte, and Asus. I have lots more videos coming at you real soon, one that's coming very, very soon. So stick around, hit the subscribe button if you're not already, check out my store for some awesome merch, and we'll see you all in the next video.